Hi. Hey, good evening. It's actually great to see you. It's much more than I expected at this time of the day for a topic which is, complex, maybe. And maybe to quickly introduce ESA, in case you have not heard of the organization. ESA is an international organization of 22 member states. It exists since more or less 50 years, and it has, of course, also associated member states such as Canada, which is quite funny, I think, because, I mean, Canada, they're close to the US. You would consider they could be a part maybe of NASA or so, but they are actually a member of ESA. ESA has a budget of 5.2 billion euro per year, approximately, so that varies a bit, and so far it has implemented over 80 missions. Here you see like a brief overview of ESA locations. I work exactly here at headquarters in Paris. This is my office door, and this is it when it's open. So it's nothing more, nothing less than a messy office in Paris, where I do this job, which is called cross-media coordination, and I take care also of the implementation of open access at ESA. Pretty old building in Paris. Last week I had it, it was a very rainy week, and it was dripping through my ceiling actually. But the fancy thing is that you can see the Eiffel Tower. There is much more fancy establishments at ESA. This is ESTEC. Actually, this is the research and technology establishment, as we call it, at ESA. It's in Noordwijk in Holland. And that was it already with regard to ESA, because now we first have to talk about WIPO. WIPO is, I guess you're here because you have probably even you are more knowledgeable as me. Nevertheless, I hope there's some insights I can share with you with what we do at IGOs and in terms of open access. WIPO, the World Intellectual Property Organization, is a UN organization. And this actually, it's a press release from 2013, and it was kind of the starting point for a movement among IGOs, which has clearly built up some, to my assumption, quite some momentum currently. The press release says that a new online licensing system, which actually is a special edition of the Creative Commons license, the IGO licensing scheme that it has been launched in December 2013. At the time, I was still working at DLR, which is the German Space Agency, but I already had the assignment to ESA. And I was contacting my future boss, and I told him, look, I'm looking forward to implement this at ESA. And he said, yeah, we'll go for it. And we did, as you will see a bit later on. We have to focus first on WIPO, because WIPO had a crucial role with regard to these licenses. You can see what WIPO has to offer, which is quite a lot of content. And it's, basically, as they call it, global services for protecting intellectual property, but also for sharing, of course. I share with you now, and I just forgot to say that originally this session was planned to have three colleagues of mine, Charlotte Bouchon from WIPO, Valeria Brancolini from CERN, and also John Cummings, who works as a Wikipedian in residence at UNESCO in Paris, across the street from where I work. And unfortunately, all three of them cannot be with us tonight, but I have their slides, as you can see. So we go here for some slides which Charlotte Bouchon has shared with me. And what Charlotte says is that UN agencies and other NGOs are quite unusual content creators. They have pretty unique content by their mandates and convention, plus they have a unique legal status in the sense that we rely in our legal schemes a lot on what is called mediation and arbitration. And these are two aspects. Actually, I'm quite nervous because Andres is here and he's a senior lecturer in IPR. He has a role or had a role with, or still has a role with Creative Commons as well. And I'm not at all a lawyer nor an IPR specialist, but somebody who has a lot of working experience with these licenses as in using them as a mainly as a science communicator. So anyway, what I can tell you from my layperson's knowledge is that with the standard Creative Commons licenses, the mediation clauses on mediation and arbitration were missing, and these have then been included in the IGO version of the Creative Commons licenses. What WIPO did, you can read it here, WIPO facilitated the negotiations between IGOs, many of them. Actually, I think we have, well, I believe more than a dozen, if not up to 20 members of that IGO working group on open access. And the process ran from 2010 to 2013, so way before I joined ESA. And with the result that with the result of this working group that the license suite of this CC 3.0 IGO licenses was published in late 2013 together with Creative Commons. 10 major IGO publishers, meanwhile, I believe even more, including the World Bank, a UN organization as well, WHO, use them for implementing their own open access policies. And WIPO continues to support, so just recently CERN and in person Valeria, who as said cannot be here tonight, joined the IGO, and hopefully there's more to follow. This is the outcome. It's the as it is the CC by SA, 3.0 IGO that we use at ESA in its latest beautiful online design. You can see here, I think, I know it's barely readable, but what you can see that WIPO themselves, as a role model, they fully implement this for all their most, for the majority of their publications and their websites. You see here, like, actually, this is the slide I wanted to show earlier. They show what information they share. So that is from website text to open access publications in the classic sense. And we now move to CERN. Well, this actually I found while researching some images from CERN, and well, I wondered and I stumbled a bit because it looks a bit like this one here, which is ESA's control center. So actually, this is the LHC control room, and I found the similarity quite funny, so I had to have it in my presentation. This is part of the LHC. Actually, here's some information which my colleague Valeria from the IGO working group contributed, and what she states is that open access was always really important for particle physics, that CERN engaged in what is called green open access until 2010, and even already in 2009, the very first LHC scientific paper was put under open access, and that meanwhile, all LHC results are published as gold open access. There is actually, it is because Valeria is not here that I sort of, it gets probably less me reading the slides in a moment, but important for CERN is that Scope 3 is mentioned, which is an initiative that makes scientific articles via the regular, so that means the established journals, freely available to everyone. I guess it's probably, and actually I do want to do my talk not longer than 30 to 40 minutes, so that we have quite some time left for discussions. By the way, if you want to ask questions in between or have remarks, you feel free to interrupt me anytime. This is with regard to the Scope 3 initiative by CERN, so an initiative, a CERN initiative to make even more content available under open access. There is also open access to monographs via CERN. As said, almost everything in the area of particle physics, and some bullets on the CERN publishing policy, which is since 2014 for GOLD OA, as mentioned earlier. The bullet number 3, which you can read here, conferences remain a difficult problem to solve, is quite valid for all the other IGOs as well, because if, for example, CERN or, for example, ESA contributes something to the proceedings of the International Astronautical Congress, one of the largest scientific technical congresses on space, which takes place every year. Usually they are being put under all rights reserved, but there is a wealth of knowledge. And while we, I myself, I have offered a talk for this year's conference, and when I uploaded the abstract, then, I mean, I automatically had to agree to all rights reserved. So what I'm trying to say is that major conference partners of the organizations, I think we still have to convince them. Valerias and Jens Wiegen, who's the head of the CERN library, their experience in open access so far are a better use of resources. Of course, the ESA reuse, you will actually read a similar slide when I come to what ESA did so far in terms of open access, that CERN prefers full OA, so favors full OA in order to, sorry, with regards to hybrid. That there is a large potential beyond journals, and you will, I will show you a bit more about this later. So now the part from my colleague John Cummings, Wikipedian in residence at UNESCO. As said, they are practically across the street from where I work. And actually, by John's contributions to the IGO working group on open access, we learned quite a lot. First, let me introduce UNESCO. I guess most of you are familiar with UNESCO, but what you would know UNESCO most is, I mean, when they're, let's be in Germany for a moment, is when there are kind of discussions with regard to a bridge in Dresden, or if the Cologne Cathedral will remain a UNESCO World Heritage because a skyscraper is building close to it, stuff like that. But in fact, they are the UN scientific organization, and they also take care of education. You can, again, barely read it in this screenshot I did here. So UNESCO is all about education, science, culture, and also communication, very important. What John does in his job at UNESCO is he takes care of adding UNESCO text to Wikipedia, because, I mean, UNESCO is actually one of the role models among international organizations with regard to open access. So many of their texts, many of their multimedia, but also classic publishing items, they are under open access for a long time. And UNESCO, for me, was also an important role model to convince not just ESA's top management, but also the level below to go for open access. So what John continuously does as a day job is adding UNESCO text to Wikipedia from the publications. he states there is a huge potential for this, and you can see here like one of UNESCO's publication and how it's being transferred to Wikipedia. The fact being that this is very credible, scientifically accurate content, which if being made available under open access, can actually go directly into Wikipedia with, a Wikipedian in residence at the organization and in close relation with the organization, of course, also has the credibility in the community to add this text to Wikipedia. Another publication, and as said, the website of UNESCO is fully under open access as well. There's, by the way, there's a German, then there's another German-based IGO, which is the European Southern Observatory. They do pretty much the same. We, for example, at ESA in the space domain, we haven't made this step yet. Again, some more examples on how texts, sorry, I'm a bit fast. You can see here text from the Global Open Access Portal at UNESCO, and you can see how, again, it flows into Wikipedia. UNESCO has a lot of media to share, actually more than we at ESA currently have under open access. There is 100K images, 1,000 or what? Thousands of hours of video and audio, graphics, etc., etc. The UNESCO Media Bank is called actually PhotoBank, and it is sort of built on the same open source software, is being built to better share this content. So what I'm trying to say here is it's not just being done that you upload your stuff to your standard digital asset management systems or to your website backends. It's also very important that you make the content accessible, so in terms of open interfaces. And you can see here that actually if you are an IGO or if you're another research organization or whatever organization that wants to share its content, that UNESCO actually makes the software available on GitHub. Soon means, I mean, these slides actually have a status as of like 1-2 months ago. It could already be there. If you need links or any further information, you can contact me after the talk. Here's examples of photos that UNESCO shares in the UNESCO Media Bank, as said, based on a software which, if I'm not wrong, is called PhotoBank. And we're now talking about data, and there's an interface to the other IGOs as well. What John writes is that he's currently working on processes to upload data from UNESCO to Wikidata, which is the Wikimedia site that holds the data. It looks like this. I believe many of you will know it. And the important fact being that Google reuses data from Wikipedia. And that's why, this is because Google understands the structure of the data in Wikipedia and actually can answer questions. If you can read the question here is, it is, how big is Yellowstone National Park? And Google actually answers this by what is stored on Wikipedia. Promoting open access, all of you being active on Wikipedia, you know that there is the campaigns listed here, Wiki Loves Earth, Wiki Loves Monuments, Wiki Loves Africa, and they look like this. Where they invite you to share as many photos with regard to the respective topics of the campaign as possible. And that largely contributes to the continuously growing, wonderful assets that you can find in Wikimedia Commons, the media repository attached to Wikipedia and run by the Wikimedia Foundation as well. This site is very important because it provides very good guidelines on how open access images you find, mostly licensed under CC BY SA or CC BY, on Wikimedia can be reused. We at ESA began recently interacting with the community to make sure that our material is uploaded there as well. So what I explained to you until now was with regard to three, and now I'm coming to Isa in a moment, four of the organizations being active in the IGO working group, but of course there's many more. Charlotte mentioned 10 major contributors so far, and the number is growing. At ISA, we started very recently. It was, you can see that the web news / press release is from 20th of February 2017, so very recently. I was only successful at ISA by embedding it in the overall ISA digital agenda, which is sort of the umbrella under which many initiatives of making ISA a more accessible, a more digital agency run. And you can read here a few of the statements why we did it. Our director general states, and actually that was kind of an eye-opener for me as well, he states that our open access initiative logically follows the free and open data policies we already have established. And the thing is, his statement sort of, it for me, opened, well, pretty much a world on its own within ISA, because it made me discover that, mostly after proprietary periods. What you have to know with regards to ISA is, ISA is actually, you can say, it's the bus that takes scientists on board and brings missions, for example, the Rosetta comet chasing mission that brings them to the comet, and then it's European, if not worldwide, scientific institutions that hop on this bus and they conduct their science. So what they have is the right to use the data first in a so-called proprietary period, which will be 6 or 12 months at times. Some data, and you will see examples of this later, is directly put under open access, under different policies. But if we talk about planetary missions, for example, they usually, or deep space missions, they usually would have a proprietary period of 6 to 12 months. But after this, and this is what Jan Werner, the Director General of DG, says here, it is fully free and open. There is, practically nothing. There's not even a license. Only thing that needs to be done is what we call acknowledgement, scientific acknowledgement. So you have to acknowledge the principal investigator, which is the chief scientist of an instrument on a mission. I'll show you a lot, fancy pics coming up soon, don't worry. So I'll show you a lot of examples later. But this is actually quite essential. So it opened sort of the wealth of data we have that can be reused by everybody. Of course, you need to have some knowledge on how to process the data in order to get your scientific results or your remixes or your creative projects, etc., etc. But you can use it in the most free way you can imagine. There is not even a license that is put on top. My colleague Gunther, of course, for him it's very important that there is a recognition of the value of information we have. So, and very frankly speaking, we want to escape as an IGO from the image of that we do things in the ivory tower and we do not share. It's more important than ever these days to share the data. More on the why later. And for me, you can see the quote I contributed myself to that release, that I truly believe all this will contribute to an overall societal benefit and what I would call more scientific literacy in the end. To tell you a bit about the story, we were with the Rosetta mission. I hope that most of you will know about that comet-chasing mission, which was largely covered by the media and very appreciated by the public. Is that we actually, what helped me is that we really we had a lot of pressure in the sense that there was a huge public demand for more imagery from the comet and from the first attempt to land on that comet. And here you can see an article where the BBC picked it up, and the headline is "Rosetta will prompt science images rethink." So actually, we were very much blamed for not releasing enough content to the public. And a measure was taken at the time. That's a blog post written by my colleague Mark McCochran and me. And we found, and that actually, what I wanted to share with you, that we could not release more of that super sharp high-res imager on the mission was with regard to the fact that there was a very, very difficult IPR situation. So where the IPR didn't fully belong to ESA, so we had to find a solution. The solution was a navigation camera, in short NavCam, which was on the mission, which had, if I'm not totally wrong, like a 5 to 6 megapixel resolution, which is pretty high if you take into account that the spacecraft was launched in 2004. In one go, we released all the images of that camera, and they're already pretty good. We released them under an open access compatible license, which was the CC BY-SA 3.0 IGO. The thing is, we went, Mark and me, Mark being the senior advisor for science of the organization, and me, a couple of levels below, really, so a guy doing digital communications in the communication department. We went completely disruptive. We bypassed everybody at the time, including the legal department, and we just did it. And with the end, that even like animations, mostly free to reuse. We'll talk about the SA module later, could be freely shared. And we could make at least one of these images per day, not per week, available. So they were processed. You have to imagine that the data transfer from like millions of kilometers away through space is relatively slow. But we managed to make these images available as the comet approached the sun. And you can see these outbursts, that they're getting more and more intense. So, that was truly fascinating, not just for us, but also for a more general public. And we would have missed a unique chance, not just to promote space science, but also, for sharing knowledge and insights. A very nice side effect of these licenses is, as you know, that you legalize remixes like this one. So we set up a Tumblr. People contributed beautiful remixes, which, personally, I love them, and I believe many people too. There's a whole archive of, maybe around 1,000 images under this address. Oh, sorry for messing up with this. Anyway, coming to Earth observation right now. Actually, the open access policy on the most accurate, high-res, up-to-date, state-of-the-art Earth observation data is not, I frankly admit this, is not an ESA policy. It's a policy by the European Union. For the European Union, we as ESA implement the so-called space segment of the Copernicus program. The space segment consists of a fleet, relatively large fleet, of satellites. And these satellites actually, they function so well that we, or let's say our ground segment managers at ESA, they have, almost they run into storage capacity problems. So it works exceptionally well. The open access policy, you can see, again, much too tiny. Complete, free, and open, so very open, obviously. You can go on this portal. There are some, I admit, quite some usability issues. It is difficult to understand. I know a couple of colleagues had trouble in really, managing to technically access the data. What I personally find interesting, as said, not being an IPR specialist, but somebody who works with licensing and terms of use quite a bit, is that the license, the European Union, or better, the Commission they set up, is pretty much similar to a Creative Commons license. It's just not—it's not called Creative Commons. Anyway, this is one of the satellites, and these are the. This is an example of the value-added products we generate. This is a simple animated GIF. It shows really devastating wildfires in on the Portuguese island of Madeira in 2016. Actually, the light is a bit too strong, so you cannot really see it. But what the most remarkable, thank you so much, the most remarkable aspect is that it can show, because of its multiple paths, the satellite, in this case an optical imaging satellite, it can show changes over time. Same applies to here, that we were in the nature just right now. Here you can see the building of the Bosporus image. Imagine what that means for the world's heritage, that these satellites can actually document the major changes on Earth's surface over time, all that being digitally stored. This has been done by experts. That's obvious. You see the license, and by the way, there was something. We didn't do well in the sense that this is free and open data. And when we published, I managed to put these images under said license only a couple of days ago, actually last week. So what we did is more or less unintentionally, we put them under all rights reserved. But remember, they come from free and open data. So we corrected this. This is really important. If you are an expert, or if you just dig deeply into that, you can do it yourself. You can generate marvelous value-added products with these satellite data. What's the purpose behind by the EU? Of course, it is. It can be used by the individual for whatever purpose, for educational purposes. But of course, it wants to boost the small, medium, or even enterprise economy sector. It wants to boost startups. Meanwhile, quite some have been founded to work with this data and to generate then value-added product, which they can. At ESA, both for scientific but also for PR purposes, we put them under BY-SA. But if you are a startup and you put even, you process the data, you put even more value to it, or you generate a value-added service, then you can put them under a more restrictive license and sell them, or what I would recommend, keep them under a free license, sell them anyway. Actually, this is for you to work with. Here, another example, still image. Actually, I don't remember what region this is. This almost looks like art, and somebody from the arts sector, actually, those of you who know me, you know that. You've often seen it, this slide, because I use it frequently. It just facilitates remixes. And what that says, it's German, it says, good morning, it's the beginning of the week, here's a beautiful image, do you have an idea what you can see here? And then there was a number of tweets, replies, and somebody by the name of Specs, Twitter handle Stonejacket, he just replied, no, that's all wrong, this is a flamingo flying over a Stegosaurus, and he did that beautiful remix. Actually, I like that so much. I mean, actually, at the time it wasn't even open access or Creative Commons, but I love this idea of remixing content. We're putting normal photos here. You see a radio testing facility at ESTEC, similar to what UNESCO does. So we focus. We don't focus. We try to put as much content from the different media categories under open access. Here is a reuse of the Philae lander from the Rosetta mission that is used in what I would call the Minecraft of space educational software, Kerbal Space Program. Wonderful if you have youngsters, if you have kids, and you love space. This is probably something you should look into. They reuse it, and I mentioned it earlier. You can see here the Planetary Science Archive, so whatever you're looking for, if it's images from Mars, or if it's spectrometer data from Mars, or magnetosphere data from whatever planet, from whatever mission, you'll all find it here. This is actually the portal, just recently being revamped, where you find that free and open data after the proprietary period has ended, and more This is even sometimes, it depends very much on the PI, on the industry, which has contributed the instrument to the mission. So instrument of a mission being like a scientific instrument being built on an orbiter or a landing or a lander or whatever spacecraft, this is what it means. And the second screenshot is from sort of our legacy Earth observation missions, so Envisat, which still have, I mean, a wealth of data from, I mean, periods until 2013, which according, and here ESA sort of followed the EU, we put that under a new policy which enables open access as well. Here you see actually, I mean, data for these images, sorry, I have to hop back one. If you, I mean, want to process your own Mars images, you just go to that search field here and you put in Mars Express HRSC, which is the imaging document, imaging instrument. You can find the data from which you can generate these pictures. This, you can see the credit here. It's you will see that we do, almost any mission we do it in cooperation with partners. The Sentinel missions in cooperation or by mandate on behalf of the European Union, European Commission. This is a joint mission with DLR and in particular a joint instrument with DLR and the Freie Universität Berlin. It's the high-resolution stereo camera which orbits Mars on the ESA mission Mars Express for more than 10 years, and it continues to deliver this wealth of imagery. And while we process them for our own communication purposes, anybody who wants, you need a bit of knowledge on how to process Mars imaging data, but you can do them on your own with the data on the portal. I just showed you there. One of the major aspects of that camera is that it's able to do 3D images, which you can see here. And again, a beautiful remix. You see that credits if you, by SA, the license, as maybe quite some of you know, requires that you that the content keeps being open. Which means that you have to put derivative works, so remixes, you have to put them under the same license. Here you see, what's not just we at ESA, but also other IGOs, but we keep, we'll stay for a moment in the space sector, that of course we compete with organizations like NASA, JPL, where you can read here that unless otherwise noted, images and video on JPL websites may be used for any purpose without any prior permission, subject to the special cases noted below. The special cases being the insignia, the logo, stuff like that, but some of you might know that a lot of the US material from NASA is under public domain. Interestingly, what we recently see with the case of the Environmental Protection Agency in the US is that while the USA has a certain tendency to go less open, it's actually opening at the very same time, I would say pure coincidence, we in Europe, we tend to be more open. And here, that's a slide I often use as well. Actually, some of you who've seen my talk here in 2013, I believe, at Republica, you can see that for us with IGOs, because of the special clauses, the special legal status we have, there is copyright is no solution. Public domain, so no copyright at all, is no solution. By the way, the attribution, super important for IGOs, because we need to show to the taxpayers who fund us that what we do is actually done by us. So they know, or hopefully they think, that the tax money that is being trustfully given to us, that it's well invested. So for us, the solution can only be Creative Commons. Once again, the license that we use, let's talk for a moment about why we use the BY-SA. I may frankly share with you that I with the former organization with DLR, I worked for until 2014, we went for CC BY. Unfortunately, multimedia, so that means images and videos only, and not sure, but there's colleagues, former and still today dear colleagues of mine here who may answer that these questions. What actually the efforts of DLR are with regards to putting more than multimedia under open access. With ESA, well, there is positive and negative aspects to the BY-SA. Other IGOs, so my colleagues whose presentations or slides I had earlier, they are more open. They use CC BY. I would have loved to do this at ESA as well, but actually for us it was a very good compromise. Coming to the positive aspect, the positive aspect is it remains open. Because there's a mandatory use of the same license for derivative works, or ask us for a waiver, and we will provide it ASAP. What that means is very important. Not sure if anybody from the media is here. If you are, for example, ZDF in Germany, or if you are BBC, and you want to use the stuff in your documentation, in your report, so TV, Belgian TV report, or a video on the web. Of course, that would mean that you put that derivative product under the same license as well. So what they always ask us for, and those whom we work with a lot, there's an established process. They send us an email, and we say, yeah, of course, we provide you we do not word it like a waiver of the SA, but you're free to use it. Thank you. So then again, remix and editing is allowed. So the positive aspect, as said, being that it remains open, but the negative is that for media, it's not exactly that easy to use. I believe most of you know Creative Commons, so let me just focus for a moment where in the field of open we are. So it's not CC0, which is public domain, it's not BY, as just explained, but we are here, so still in the open field, whereas you can see that here it gets more and more restrictive. So these are not, and they have never been an option for us. Once again to Wikipedia. Engaging with Wikipedia is very important for us. You can see that when we put an image on the when we put an image online, this is a depiction of our Mercury orbiter, which will launch early next year, that it doesn't take long until it appears there, which is great, to illustrate the article. And you can see that actually this has huge impact, way more impact than we could ever imagine on our own website. You see here details for content being created by ESA in the month of March, and that totals to 35 million page views. That is mainly Hubble, which is a joint ESA-NASA mission, but it's also, you can see, and this really struck me, this is kind of, you see here February, more or less around the time when we launched open access officially at ESA and had put a bunch of content already online. So it really does matter. And something like this, with which the Rosetta spacecraft took flying by Mars, I have been approached by the Wikipedia community that they would like it to make the top image of the English language Mars article, and they did. And if you imagine that this then has like 220K impressions a month, this page alone, it does really matter in terms of reach and in spreading. I mean, what the lead editors of these articles consider as the image, it wasn't me who introduced it to them. They asked for it because they knew about our open access initiative. Here's a user which just started pumping, as it's called in the Wikipedia language, which I just recently learned, all the Sentinel images. We put like almost 200 under open access last week, and they are being pumped into Wikimedia Commons. So engaging with that community is very, very important. Wikipedia is currently looking into sharing 3D models on Wikimedia Commons. It's not Wikipedia, it's Wikimedia Commons looking into sharing 3D models as well. This one can be downloaded even for use of on the 3D printer or wherever, can be downloaded under CC as well. And actually, I'm coming to the end. And if we may, we can hear that sound. And hopefully, there is some 10 to 15 minutes left for questions and discussions while we listen to the sound. Okay, we share a lot of sounds, scientific sonifications as well. Some of you maybe know the so-called singing comet. Actually, that's the comet, which is really emitting these sounds, but far beyond what we can hear. So what you can hear here is a sonification by Technical University Braunschweig, who led the instrument, which actually captured the data, which we made, a German artist and composer by the name of Tagirius, our real name Manuel Senft, what they made audible. You can hear it, and the last bit I would like to play then, when this one finished, is a remix which an Italian artist did, and he turns this in kind of some Daft Punk-esque electronic piece. So let me check what I have left. I think, it's the other way around. Yeah, some info where you can find content, how you can contact me in case actually I'll share this presentation happily with you and all the content. You have to respect the individual copyright because I'm not sure if there's any all rights reserved content, but probably I can't put it entirely under the CC BY, but I'll nevertheless share it as widely as possible with you. So while we listen, actually imagine what you hear right now is all from that singing comet sample. So even if something to you sounds like an analog synth or a bass drum, it's not. It's the singing comet. So this is actually an electronic piece created entirely from, again, a sound which we put under a Creative Commons license. I'd like to close with this, and I'm hopefully you want to continue to discuss for a moment. I know there's a session after this one. So I believe, is there some 10 minutes left or so? Super. Okay. Thank you.
Gibt es Fragen, Reaktionen, Rückmeldungen? Da vorne.
Hi, Jennifer. I'm a researcher at the University of Potsdam on international organizations. So I was very interested in hearing whether you got feedback from countries on, you know, whether they like that you're putting much more data out there. You talked about accountability to the governments, to the parties of the international organizations. Could you tell us a bit about that?
Yeah, I'm afraid, could you turn the volume of the audience mic up a little bit? Because I didn't fully get it, I'm sorry.
Closer?
Yeah. Oh yeah, like that's this? Much better. Sorry. I'm sorry, yeah.
Not a public speaker. So in the beginning you talked about the accountability aspect of getting open access and putting your data out there. I'd be interested in hearing about feedback you might have gotten from governments, from countries, in whether they acknowledge this effort, whether they appreciate it, whether it helps, you know, getting funding from countries. Thank you.
Feedback. I mean, feedback from the general public of all member states. I mean, with regard to my personal situation at ESA was overly positive. But what I can share with you is that it is very individual with regard, to countries. So while some would be more reserved or maybe not, actually not really excited about this, others openly embrace it. Actually, I think I cannot name the countries because they are all our member states, but some tend to continue to have a more restrictive policy. I may also share with you that, we are an international organization and what is pretty normal, and while you work, for example, at an organization like ESA, you do not really realize, but that every day, let's imagine like a typical working day from morning to evening, and you would have talked to colleagues from at least, we're 22, but on an average day you talk to like 10 different nations or member state colleagues, and you get like maybe 5 to 6 to 7 different opinions. So while the take of one country, maybe a more conservative one, we have, for example, Estonia as our member states. They would very openly embrace what we do. And we just had a meeting with colleagues from Estonia who are actually the most digital country, a very small one, which infrastructure-wise makes it easier, but they are fully digital, they are fully open, they are committed to sharing, and we're doing joint projects in the field of data in future together. So hopefully that answers your question a bit.
Right here. Do you and your team, or also the other organizations you talked about, do you ever discuss not publishing any of the data? Some of the data. Do you see a reason why some data might not want to, should be published?
Definitely. There is data which may be sensitive and which just. ESA is. The convention is that ESA works fully for peaceful purposes, so we do not have any military data. But nevertheless, there could be sensitive data, and that we cannot publish. And I think, the case where, the usual case where it's very difficult is when it comes. Actually, an aspect I deliberately didn't mention is when it comes to person's right of privacy, personality rights. So, for example, that there's still, even if we use the BY-SA license, which is a bit more restrictive in terms of the three, in context of the three open licenses, there is still, for example, a fear ESA internally that if we would share an astronaut's image, like astronaut full portrait, that it could be used for advertising purposes, advertising and commercial uses. You can read this. I believe the NASA website has just recently got more restrictive. So they kind of reinforced what, even if all the images are on the public domain, what it means if you use images of an individual or any kind of NASA image in a commercial context. Here, we clearly, with the BY-SA, we allow commercial use, but nevertheless, my legal department asks me for the moment to refrain from publishing any persons if they are recognizable. So this is clearly stuff we currently cannot publish.
Okay, there's a question in front.
So you described ESA as an organization offering a bus trip on a spacecraft for the scientific community. And did I understand correctly that from now on, if I was a senior scientist at some Max Planck Institute or some university, and I would like to fly my scientific instrument on your bus trip to the next comet or planet, I would have to sign an agreement stating that I have to put all the data and images I publish under open access after those 6 or 12 months. Did I understand that correctly?
Well, yes. There is, for example, the current Mars mission, you just saw Mars Express, the current one is ExoMars, right? There was exactly that case where the principal investigator of the high-risk imager on ExoMars, Cassis, he actually asked us to go public domain with all the images, his, I mean, he considers it his instrument. It's in terms of IPR, it's much more complicated. It's kind of a very complex set of rights, but he asked us to go public domain, which, as said, we have, I mean, we have to report back to the taxpayer. We need this attribution. We need that it stays, says ISA, ExoMars, CASIS, and possibly, in that case, the PI comes from the University of Bern, which we do not, I mean, by his own wish, but we mention his experiment or instrument name rather than the institution. But we need to report this back, so public domain, why public domain was not an option. Now, of course, we agreed on that we do it with the CC license. So, yes, and then again, maybe just to add, this is all being done in discussion with the scientists. The scientists make proposals, and ESA with a board that consists also of other members from the science community, so ESA does not decide on its own. They agree on which instrument comes, and you are mentioning, and I'll finish with my reply after this, is that it's really very important that we take this into account from the mission conception phase already.
There's room for one more question, if it's a little one. Any remarks? All right.
Okay.
If not, you can catch me. Any last words or?
Sorry?
Any last words from you or?
No, I just would like to thank you so much. It was a pleasure to deliver this talk. And if you have any more questions or want to continue the discussion, I'll be available.
Okay, but then again, thanks from our side.